Dennis, banks in Canada recently coming out with their forecasts for interest rate increases over the course of 2022 and into 23, anywhere from 150 to 200 basis points. Give us an idea of what you think market reaction will be, or will there even be a market reaction? And we've been anticipating this news for quite some time now.
Right. Well, I think if the Bank of Canada were to increase the overnight rate by 150 to 200 basis points, they'd be in danger of tightening monetary policy in Canada much more so than is anticipated in the United States. And the Canadian dollar has already started to reflect the fact that tightening in Canada might be more than in the United States. And as a result, you've seen the dollar appreciate versus the US dollar. So I'm not sure the Bank of Canada is comfortable with the Canadian dollar appreciating at its current trajectory and continuing to do so into the future. So I have a hard time believing that the Bank of Canada is going to tighten monetary policy that much going forward. 100 basis points, sure, that would match what the Federal Reserve Bank in the United States is anticipated to do. But even that, I think, is overly hawkish, if you will. I think three interest rate hikes of 25 basis points each for both central banks is probably where we'll end up this year.
Ultimately, are investors ready for these rate hikes?
I think the market has currently gotten a little ahead of itself in terms of pricing in rate hikes. You've heard chatter about four rate hikes out of the US. You've heard chatter about 50 basis points increase starting in March. And you've heard chatter about the Bank of Canada going as early as this month. I think right now the market is overly focused on the supply chain bottlenecks and the fact that the Omicron variant of the COVID-19 virus continues to cause problems. Looking forward, however, it's highly likely that the pandemic has crested and peaked in the first quarter of 2022, and that later on this year, we will have dealt with most of the virus's impacts. As a result, we think the supply chain bottlenecks will ease and some of the upward pressure on inflation will start to come back. So, you know, investors, I think, have overly priced in monetary tightening. And I think in the second half of the year, they'll start to unwind some of those moves you've seen in the market and that equity markets will respond a little more favorably.
How ultimately do you see this inflation story? Last year, we were talking about it being transitory. It seems like it's been much longer than expected. Well, how do you categorize it? How do you define it?
Right. So there's certainly elements of inflation that will prove to be transitory. However, a number of some of the key drivers of inflation, like, for instance, the housing market, will prove to be a little more resilient or prove to be a little more sticky than investors probably originally forecasted. So I think that the central banks are right to start tightening monetary policy, to start increasing interest rates, if you will, on the short end. But keep in mind that what that means is that future growth and future inflation should come down. And so as a result, long end of the yield curve probably isn't going to move much, but your outlook for growth is going to come back. So I think investors should be cognizant of that. If you look at what happened last year at this time, the long end of the yield curve started to move up. And as a result, we're seeing a slowdown in economic activity now. If the short end of the yield curve starts to go up and we start to put the brakes on economic activity, then I think you're going to see similar declines in economic output and production. So investors should keep that in mind as they start to allocate capital.
When you consider all of these elements, high inflation, interest rates, bond yields, how should investors think about them in their portfolio?
I mean, if you're expecting inflation to moderate to, say, 3% by the end of the year, unless the 10-year bond yield gets north of 3%, which is highly unlikely, then you're looking at negative real returns, especially on an after-tax basis. So what that does is it pushes investors into investments that have real returns, meaning that they're generating absolute returns, whether it be from appreciation or income, that are greater than the rate of inflation. So recent prints out of the United States were 7% inflation. You really can't get that out of fixed income. So you're really looking to the equity markets. So as much as we've seen equity markets, you know, retreat to start off this year, if real interest rates are going to continue to be negative, you're going to see capital move back into the equity markets. And they'll be seeking equities that have got defensible and demonstrable growth to offset the fact that inflation is a little higher than most people were expecting.
Let's just go back a little bit with respect to central banks. Do you think that they are behind the curve, or are they really stuck between this rock and a hard place, you know, stuck between, rapid rate rises and ultimately, I guess, doing nothing and waiting for this to pass?
Yeah, it's important to keep in mind that central banks are always behind the curve. Okay, the last thing you want is a central banker anticipating what's going to happen, setting monetary policy accordingly, and then being wrong. So central banks are always behind the curve because they're always data-driven and they always want confirmation of what's taking place in the economy before they then react. So the question we have now is that prognosticators and economists and strategists are suggesting that the North American central banks are well behind the curve and that as a result, they're going to have to do more and greater rate hikes to catch up. I suspect that's not going to be the case. And so as a result, you're going to see economic growth slow a little bit as we start to increase interest rates. You're going to see inflation start to come back, and investors are going to have to allocate capital into equities that have got the ability to compound capital at a rate higher than you're seeing in inflation and to account for the fact that global growth everywhere is slowing.
What are you telling your investors?
To stay strategic and long-term. At the end of the day, you always want to buy companies that have the ability to grow their cash flows faster than the average typical business. That doesn't change no matter what place you are in the business cycle or the economic cycle. So take these pullbacks as an opportunity to allocate more capital to those great businesses that have tremendous visibility over their ability to grow free cash flow and return that to investors. That's always the strategy.